Back in the day, when one country wanted to take over another country, they had to beat them in a war. But now, it looks like a country might have found a way to take over another country with the stroke of a pen.
The scars of colonialism run deep in Africa. Still, as the African continent is trying to turn the page to a new chapter, Africa finds itself facing predominantly economic limitations, rather than being confined by physical constraints. China, a rising nation going toe-to-toe with the United States, is slowly weaving a web of influence across the continent, raising concerns from the global West and powerful individuals of a neo-colonial trap driven by debt. TSN explores China's rapidly growing economic footprint in Africa, its motivations, and the potential consequences for the continent as a whole, whether positive, negative, or perhaps a gray area that requires a special understanding. Is China's massive investment in the African continent really for the benefit of the African people, or is Africa becoming China's China? The narrative begins not in Africa, but on the world stage, which has usually been the case with many other decisions regarding many African countries. In 1971, during a pivotal United Nations vote on China's representation, Africa stood with the West. Fast forward to 2007, the scene is a stark contrast. This time, on the issue of human rights, Africa aligns with China. What explains this dramatic shift? The answer lies in the strategic use of China's economic muscle. China's foray into Africa began with seemingly sudden acts of philanthropy, which were colossal loans offered for infrastructure projects such as roads, power plants, and many more. Modern railways, like the ones slicing through Kenya, in just 4.5 hours, colossal dams in Guinea, transforming them from power deficit nations to net exporters, and light rail systems in Addis Ababa, the first of its kind in sub-Saharan Africa, alleviating crippling traffic congestion. These became symbols of progress for these countries. But beneath the gleaming facade lies a harsh reality.
Why are they so evil?
These projects are usually financed by hefty Chinese bank debts that traditional lenders deem risky, with limited potential for return on investment and a high likelihood of default. China, however, saw an opportunity, a foothold in a resource-rich continent that had a desperate need for modernization. Herein lies the crux of the neo-colonial argument. The Chinese government usually presents these loans as aid with no strings attached. However, a closer look reveals a labyrinth of hidden strings. The Central European Institute of Asian Studies indicates that African nations that recognize Taiwan, a territory that China claims it owns, receive fewer projects from the Chinese government. Conversely, those consistently voting with China on the world stage are rewarded with more infrastructure investments, more railways and roads. This subtle manipulation steers African nations towards aligning with China's political agenda. Additionally, the terms of the loans are often opaque, raising concerns about predatory lending practices. Even though interest rates on the loans may be low, repayment schedules can be unforgiving, potentially crippling a nation's ability to invest in other essential social services like education and healthcare. China's motivations, however, are multifaceted. Fueling its economic juggernaut, China craves resources. Africa, a treasure trove of minerals from copper in Zambia to cobalt in the Democratic Republic of Congo, critical for the production of lithium-ion batteries that power many of the world's electric vehicles and portable electronics, emerges as the perfect supplier. China's domestic resource reserves are dwindling fast, and securing a steady supply of raw materials is essential for maintaining its position as the number one manufacturing hub. But China's hunger extends beyond just resources. Its own workforce, which was once cheap and plentiful, is becoming increasingly expensive as the nation develops. Enter Africa with a vast pool of cheap labor, a gold mine for Chinese factories. This low-cost labor force allows Chinese companies to maintain their competitive edge on the global market, especially in labor-intensive industries like garment manufacturing. The relocation of factories to Africa also has the added benefit of reducing transportation costs and bringing production closer to growing consumer markets. The shadow of a new kind of colonialism in Africa is growing bigger every day. China extracts resources, utilizes cheap labor, and wields economic influence to gain political allies. And while colonialism of the past involved direct territorial control, this new iteration operates through economic dependence. African nations become beholden to China, their economies tethered to the success of these Chinese projects, and are vulnerable to fluctuations in the Chinese market. The West, meanwhile, seems to be sleepwalking through this critical moment. Preoccupied with other geopolitical concerns, it has largely neglected Africa's massive potential. This inattention creates a vacuum that China is readily filling. The West's traditional model of foreign aid, often tied to good governance and human rights reforms, can be cumbersome and bureaucratic, failing to meet the immediate needs of African nations. The effects of China's growing influence in Africa are still largely unclear. While infrastructure projects undeniably bring development, the burden of debt can and is crippling many African economies. Some of these large-scale projects often displace local communities, raising concerns about social justice. Additionally, reliance on China for resources and markets can limit Africa's ability to diversify its own economy, locking it into a supplier role within the global economic system. Moreover, the exploitation of cheap labor raises concerns about ethical production practices and the well-being of African workers. There have been reports of unsafe working conditions, long hours, and low wages in Chinese-owned factories in Africa. The environmental impact of large-scale resource extraction also requires careful consideration. Mining often leads to deforestation, water pollution, and land degradation, jeopardizing the livelihoods of future generations. In fact, in some mining communities in Africa, for example in Ghana, are already experiencing devastating consequences of these mines, such as babies born with no gender or other serious health complications. However, the narrative is not without potential for a more balanced relationship between the African continent and China. China's investments can be a catalyst for continental growth, but African nations must tread cautiously. Also, diversifying lenders and negotiating favorable loan terms with clear repayment structures and collateral requirements, and focusing on sustainable development is crucial for the long-term development of the African continent. African nations should also learn from their past mistakes and avoid falling into a debt trap. They can establish sovereign wealth funds to manage resource revenues effectively and invest in strategic sectors to build domestic capacity. Furthermore, Africa needs to leverage its own resources strategically. Instead of simply exporting raw materials, African nations could utilize them to develop domestic industries, creating jobs and generating higher value exports. For example, instead of exporting raw cobalt, Africa could invest in refineries to produce lithium-ion battery components, capturing a larger share of the profits in the global battery market. This strategy would require significant investment in education and training programs to equip the workforce with the necessary skills. The West, too, needs to awaken from their slumber. Africa is a continent continuously brimming with potential and an economic powerhouse in the making. With a young and growing population, vast resources, and fertile land, Africa presents a unique opportunity for investment and collaboration. By offering competitive investments in infrastructure development, promoting fair trade practices that ensure African producers receive a fair share of the profits, and fostering good governance through capacity-building programs and anti-corruption initiatives, the West can create a more equitable partnership with Africa. The narrative of Africa's future can certainly be rewritten. It does not have to be a story of dependence on a single powerful actor, by learning from the past, making strategic choices, and forging new and relevant partnerships, Africa can chart its course towards sustainable development and prosperity. The continent has the potential to become a global player, not just a resource supplier or a market for cheap labor. The responsibility lies with African leaders to leverage China's investments strategically, diversify their partnerships, and invest in their people. The future of this continent and its impact on the global stage hinges on the choices made today. The numerous partnerships between China and the African continent are not without their own risks, but with careful maneuvering and a focus on long-term development goals, Africa can emerge as a strong and independent player in the global economic landscape. Thanks for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to give it a like, and also subscribe to the channel to see more videos like this.